Next up, let's talk about error handling. But before we do that, let's make sure that we understand how do errors work in Ansible. What we have here are four different machines: Bender, Fry, Zoidberg, and Farnsworth. Each of them have three tasks to complete. And what winds up happening is that in our first task, Farnsworth fails. Bender and Fry, no change, and Zoidberg does change, but Farnsworth is the one that failed out. Something happened with task one. What winds up happening is that Farnsworth alone will not continue through the remainder of the tasks inside of this playbook. Bender, Fry, Zoidberg, totally unaffected, but an error means that you stop. Do not pass go, do not collect $200. In task number two, Zoidberg has failed on this task, but Bender and Fry did not. Zoidberg does not move on to task three. However, whatever change occurred in task one still applies. It does not undo what has happened previously. And then if Fry fails on task number three, Fry doesn't continue any further, but then again, that's also the end of the playbook. So this is desirable after all, that just because one host failed does not mean that you want to hold back the rest. And if a host does fail, then you don't want them to continue and create more damage as they move along. In fact, this is often sometimes desirable, that if you are going to fail, you should pull a Farnsworth and you should fail on task number one. Why? Because you might find yourself in a situation where Zoidberg made a change, but the fact that that change was made successfully may be undesirable if Zoidberg fails to complete future changes. That's called pre-checking, and we'll get more into that later. Now, error handling in Ansible, the way that this works is that you are looking to, if an error is encountered, skip over that erroneous task and continue on later down through the rest of the playbook. The only way for that to occur is by using block and rescue. Block is the process of taking one or more tasks and basically grouping them together, hence putting them into a block of tasks. And if an error occurs on one of those tasks, it doesn't matter which one, then what will happen is that a rescue task will allow the continuation of the playbook. Now, a picture is worth a thousand words, so let's take a look. Take a second and take in what this playbook is having us do. It's nothing fancy. We're just running a series of shell commands where we echo out some string and then we write that string into a file, example.txt. So by the time that this is done, example.txt should have three lines of text inside of it. Now, in order to make these tasks as part of a block, this is what we'll have to do. Let's indent those tasks a little bit further to the left. And right here at the normal level of indentation for our tasks is where we would put the name of a block. We're going to name this block block because this is what we are trying to do. Functionally, nothing has changed about the way that this playbook runs. It's just that these three shell tasks have all been put inside of a group together. In fact, if we were to save down to the command line here and we were to execute this playbook, then inside of Bender, Fry, Zoidberg, and Farnsworth, there's a file called example.txt. You'll note, hey, all three of those tasks successfully ran. Nothing too exciting there. Now, let's go back inside of our playbook and let's cause some errors to occur. If I were to say that I wanted to use the fail module The fail module will intentionally trigger errors to occur. So, the second task inside of our block is what is going to cause the error here. So let's see what happens when we try and run that playbook again. Notice that the first task succeeded, but the second task failed as expected. And note that there is no third task. Benderfry, Zoidberg, and Farnsworth did not continue to example task 3 because that is the nature of errors inside of Ansible. Now, we can deflect this by adding in underneath our block a section called rescue. You're going to want to check your indentation when you're dealing with this stuff. So looking over here, the B in block is 5 spaces in from the right. If I come down here, I can see rescue, also 5 spaces. Great. Rescue allows us to specify tasks that will run when an error occurs. Note that what this shell command does is that it echoes, my rescue code ran. Maybe it undoes whatever the block tried to do. So, let's see what happens if we run this playbook one more time. The second task is still failing, as it's supposed to. But note, this time, a rescue task kicked in. And if we go back to Zoidberg and we take a look at Bender, rather, at what's inside of example.txt. Okay. The first task wrote to example.txt. The second task was the rescue. So my rescue code ran. Maybe it undoes whatever the block tried to do. Pretty cool. So you can have any number of rescue tasks that can be set to trigger in the event that a failure occurs inside of a block. Now, the last thing that I'd like to show you here is that along with block and rescue is also always. So these three sections are tied to each other. Rescue only runs in the event of an error. And always, well, it always runs, whether there was an error or not. So if I were to save and run this playbook one more time, now that I have this always section, whoops, got a little indentation issue, and we'll run that again. All right, our rescue task ran because we threw an error, and the always task ran because, well, that's what always happens. So if I take a look at example.txt on Bender, you can see that the always entry is present inside of that file. Now, riddle me this, students, that if I were to get rid of that fail module inside of my block, then what's going to be inside of example.txt when I run this a final time? Looks like our two tasks in the block executed. It looks like our always executed. But the rescue did not, because there was nothing to rescue. There was no error to handle. So this sort of thing is invaluable in being able to set up smartly defined scripts. Consider using these inside of playbooks where you should have some sort of check before the entire playbook runs. For our last play that we're going to take a look at inside of this lab, this is a playbook that has stages and also reflects best practices in how you should include error handling techniques inside of your playbooks. The idea is that when you write a playbook that is checking to see if its hosts should be executed against, that's called a pre-check. To make sure that the changes that you made were effective, you should include what's known as a post-check. So let's take a look through this playbook. Here we have a list of apps to install. Note that this is written in an array format. That's perfectly fine. In our pre-check phase, what we're doing is that we are intentionally triggering a fail, like we saw earlier. And we want that fail to occur when the operating system of our host is not equal to Debian. So if this were a Farnsworth machine, which would not be able to run apt, for instance, we should have Farnsworth fail first thing so that he does not continue on to future parts of this playbook. Down here, our next block of tasks are part of the maintenance phase. So this would be the actual tasks that's performing the work that we want to do. If a host has reached these tasks at this point, then it must mean they must be a Debian device, right? So we use apt to install all of those services, and then we use the service module to make sure that all of those services are started. Now, if something happens in the process of either installing or enabling those services, what you should do is you should clean up after yourself if that occurred. So in our rescue section, remember, this will only happen if there was an error in installing. We'll have apt uninstall those services. And then, because we don't want that failed device to continue on to future tasks, then we'll throw in another fail that will cause them to reach the end of the line. So fail can really be your friend, because you often don't want hosts to continue on into erroneous territory, and fail will basically put on the brakes. In the post-check phase, this block of tasks are all about just getting information on how services are running. The service facts will grab info on how services are running on each of our future Futurama machines. This is printing out what the state of those facts are. And if those services have not been successfully installed, we will fail. And it's important that we give the Ansible user clear output, letting them know that something is wrong. So we're using a lot of the fail module here, not just to control when hosts run, but also to let users know, hey, something's wrong here. So if we look through all of those services and we take a look at the state of those services, and when the state of those services is not equal to running, well, looks like that service did not install correctly. And in that case, we should fail that particular host. And once again, because this is inside of a block, the attached rescue will uninstall any of those erroneous applications from our remote hosts. What's not running inside of this lab, but is included for your education, is a good use of always. Something that you would always perhaps want to do is to add some sort of task that gives an update to the Ansible user that's maybe a little bit more accessible. For instance, the mail module can actually send email. So we don't include that inside of this lab, but you are more than welcome to experiment with it. So consider that intelligently written playbooks are always done in stages, that they are intelligent enough to shut down badly performing hosts and to inform the user either way how things went when all is said and done.